Now that we've got the basics of Brownie under our belt, let's learn how we can stitch it all together into some more complex applications. We've talked a lot about curve, but did you know curve is a companion site called convex, shown here on the left? Convex allows you to deposit into curve, but from there, instead of staking into the curve rewards gauge, you can stake into the convex associated rewards gauge and allow them to manage your liquidity. In some cases, this can mean you get much better rewards. So here you can see all the curve pools and their projected APR. How are you to know which is actually going to be the best for your particular situation? Well, we've built a script in Brownie. We'll run it first so you can see what it looks like, and then we'll go through and dissect exactly what it looks like and how we got to this. In this case, we took a random user. You can see the account there. Don't know who it is, so I'm not doxing anyone. We're testing the effect of pool 10, which is the Gemini USD pool. And first we just look and see what would happen if we did nothing. If we do absolutely nothing, this user has no money in the either curve or convex Gemini USD pool, so they earn absolutely nothing. Then we're gonna mint 100,000 DAI, and we're gonna leave it for 24 hours. For this case, if you aped into curve, this 100,000 DAI would net the person about $25.38. Whereas if they'd staked into convex, they'd earn $2.02. In this case, they're much better off staking in curve. On the right-hand side, we've built a companion script that looks through all the eligible pools, and you can see the results. In some cases, like pool 4, convex, pool 9, convex is the clear winner. In other cases, curve does much better. How do we build these scripts? We're utilizing most of the knowledge we've learned throughout our Brownie tutorials to date. So we're gonna include the helpers utilities that we've built out. On line 11, we're gonna be loading a contract directly from its alias. So see the last unit if that's not loading for you. On line 14, we define our whale. And here on line 17, if you just run this script outright, you can pass a staking pool and then run this meaty compare curve to convex script. With the verbose flag set to true, we get all this great debugging output. And you can see where we're running it for 24 hours. We're utilizing a lot of chain properties in this. So we're picking a final time, which is going to be 24 hours in the future. For our test amount, we'll talk about how we use the mintable fork token to print money in just a little bit. Then we're going to take our chain snapshot, mine forward, see how we do by calling this load claimable balance, and revert. Test one and test two are pretty much the exact same, except on line 61, we deposit to curve. On line 71, we deposit to convex. And finally, when we're done, we're calling a chain reset, which gives us a fresh start from scratch so that when we run the script over here, it doesn't get polluted. Lines 85 through 98, when we deposit, it's pretty simple. We deposit into curve. And you'll notice the difference in the deposit to convex function on lines 102 onwards is that after this initial curve add, on the curve case, we simply stake into the curve target rewards pool. In the convex case, the logic forks a little bit and we pull the convex booster and deposit in the convex pool. The logic to add liquidity to a curve pool. Here we have a way of just distinguishing between a meta pool, which requires a little bit of extra work, or calling this add liquidity function directly. Calling add liquidity down here runs the approval and then it deposits the money. If we're doing the meta pool, then we first add to the meta pool and then we deposit into the associated final pool. There is a zapper. We haven't gotten into that yet though. To calculate our rewards, first we scrape our curve positions, then we scrape our convex positions. To scrape through all the curve pools, pretty simple. You were going to note that we're calling this get claimable curve reward function, which we'll look at in a second. And then it converts this into total USD by multiplying times the current spot price of curve that we defined up when we were defining our globals. And this is what tells us what the curve pool balance is going to be. Convex runs very similar logic, except it's calling the get claimable convex rewards function. So the get claimable curve rewards function is utilizing the chain. Since we're dealing with snapshots, we have to simply run a chain.undo after we call the mint or mint. This tells us the exact number of tokens. To get the claimable convex rewards, we do a lot of fancy math here. If you don't like the fancy math, then you can just run a claim and undo. That'll get you an exact number. I've tested the logic and it's pretty good, although it may change if these cliffs change. So be on the lookout for that if you're using this for the long term in production. But what's nice about this is it's native, so you can run this even outside of a mainnet fork. Helper functions. This takes us back to our mintable fork token. Any mintable fork token you can pass, it's going to require an alias or a contract address. Once you have that, it will mint however much money you need. Loading curve contracts. We're dealing with convex pool IDs because some cases convex doesn't always have a pool for a curve pool. So we want to work from the convex pool IDs. And this is simply going to return the curve pool, the associated ERC20 liquidity provider token, and the curve reward pool gauge. So for staking a curve, we need this. For staking a convex, we have to get the convex reward gauge. Here's a simple function just to get the pool name from the registry, helpful for our verbose debugging. Advanced chain tries to both mine forward a number of blocks and to a final timestamp. It's useful for very high precision calculations, but you have to be very careful when using it. If you're dealing with relatively small, simple cases, you could just mine by blocks or timestamp. And safe approval simply checks to see if the allowance exists. And if not, it tries to approve the remainder and it will fail gracefully. Finally, let's take a look at the CRV versus CVX, which is even easier. We simply pull in the script from this directory. Being able to pull in scripts is what's going to allow you to build more complex applications. We load the registry, loop through all the pools by count, and we calculate the output dollar value for curve and for convex. We set verbose to false, and if the pool exists, has a positive value, then we report the results here. Easy enough. So a lot of code here. Play with it. Feel free to improve on it. Tell us how you like it. Tell us if this is useful, or if you find ways to do it faster. There are a few, and we're going to get into some of them in upcoming lessons. So we look forward to hearing your thoughts. Thank you very much.